Good morning, friends.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship here at Holland UCC. It is good to have you with us. Well, our string of beautiful Sundays has come to an end, but it is still beautiful to be together with you. For those of you joining here indoors at Fort 393, and those of you tuning in online, we're glad that you're with us as well this morning. We are a community of justice, peace, and affirmation where everyone is welcome to the table. We believe that no matter the shade of your skin, how you identify, who you love, or where you are on your journey, you are a beloved child of God. Well, this morning we're kicking off our UCC Kids time for K through fifth graders, and that'll happen a little bit later in the service. You'll be invited to follow the crowd upstairs for a time of lesson and craft. And this morning in our text, Jesus says, unless you receive the kingdom like a child, you will not enter the kingdom of God. And so we will explore together what we can learn from children, of course, after we dismiss them to go upstairs. I don't know if we timed that quite right, but there it is. Well, it's so good to be together. As we're settling in here, I invite you to get comfortable in your seat. Maybe lean back a little bit. Maybe close your eyes. We'll just seek to be present here and now in this moment. I invite you to take a deep breath in. Breathing in goodness and joy, and breathing out. Breathing in possibility and hope, and exhale. And as we continue in our mindful breathing, we ring this meditation bowl, which reminds us of the deep peace of God. Let you stand if you're able and join us for our opening song.
Listening ears, all nature sings.
Steve, you may be seated. I have for our prayer this morning a children's gratitude prayer, and I asked my kids if one of them would read this, but of course that was shot down immediately. But if there is a kid who would like to read our prayer this morning, you could come up front. I've got a microphone. It's printed out right here. It's not long. Do we have one? No, you're standing up for other reasons. All right. Oh, we got one up here. All right. Thank you, Remy. You can just hold it there. Okay, got that? Let's pray together.
God, thank you for this day. Thank you for the birds and the animals and the flowers and the trees, the lakes and the streams, and the sun that rises and sets almost on each day. Thank you for creating everything we see. Thank you for the life we live and for making each person different. Thank you, Jesus, who lived and welcomed everyone, even children. It is amazing to be alive, and you are amazing, God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well done.
Amen. Thank you so much. Great job. Extra sticker this morning. Well done. Well, peace be with you, friends.
And also with you.
Please take a moment, offer a word of peace or just a hello to someone who is near you. And peace to you, friends. Great to see folks online passing the peace as well. Peace to all of you friends who are tuning in from home on this rainy Sunday. I invite you to remain standing if you're able. I know there's a lot up and down here. Our litany of the litany this morning is a litany of giving up. And I'll read the regular type, and together let's respond with the Lord. We give up the idea that we have no voice. We refuse to believe that we are powerless. We give up the idea that we cannot make a difference. We can't make a difference in and through our churches, our neighborhoods, our country, and our world. We give up the idea that our vision of a better tomorrow must wait. We do not need to wait until we're older or richer or smarter or more holy. We give up the idea that violence ever solves anything. We will not listen to those who lie to us when they say we must go to war to be safe. We give up the idea that we are not responsible for our environment. We will stop taking our earth for granted and begin to hear her voice. We give up the idea that worship only happens indoors. Man, I wanted to be outside for that line. But, you know, there it is. We give up the idea that worship only happens indoors and behind stained glass. We will remember that our daily bread comes from God through a living, healthy planet, and that we must care for her as she cares for us. We give up the idea that even when we are healthy, sickness does not affect us. We have a responsibility to act as healers through prayer and touch and action. We give up the idea that healthcare must be for only a few. We have a responsibility to care for our neighbors, all of them. We give up the idea that children must wait to make a difference. The prophet has said, "And a child shall lead them." And so together we say, we give up on this so-called wisdom of the world, but we do not give up on each other. We walk in faith together for a better tomorrow. Amen, and may it be so. You may be seated. A verse for reflection this morning is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, verse 9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Our poem this morning is entitled Nowhere Else to Go. Nowhere Else to Go by Linda Sue Park. Turn off the lights. Wear another layer. Sounds like a dad. Sounds like a mom. You say hand me down. I say retro. Walk. Bike. Walk some more. Recycle. See what I did there? Bike. Recycle. Your name in Sharpie on a good water bottle. Backpack. New habits. No thanks, don't need a bag. What else? Oh yeah, tell 10 friends. Who can tell 10 friends? Who can tell 10 friends? Make enough noise, maybe the grown-ups will finally hear the scream in the title. Nowhere Else to Go by Linda Sue Park. At this time, our kindergartners through fifth graders are invited to head upstairs for our UCC Kids Time, time of lesson and craft. Follow your leaders, Miss Sydney and Miss Krista. There's crayons, markers, and fun ahead. This time, I'll invite our reader forward.
Words of integration and guidance from Sally Miller. I was having one of those mornings. I was making my daughter's packed lunch while coaxing her to get dressed. My two-year-old was hanging off my leg, complaining at the top of his voice. Nobody was listening to me. For the umpteenth time, I told my daughter to get ready for school. She peered up at me. My daughter can always sense my moods. Don't worry, Mommy, she said. We have plenty of time. Let's play a game first. I took a deep breath, fighting to find some inner calm. My daughter was right. We did have time. We didn't need to leave the house for another 40 minutes. We settled on the floor and devoted the next 20 minutes to building Lego castles. Even my youngest cheerfully joined in. Once we were done, my daughter took herself upstairs and got ready for school. We teach our kids everything. It starts with learning how to walk and to talk. As they grow older, we teach them how to function in this crazy world we live in. What we sometimes forget is that kids can also teach us. A reading of scripture from Psalm 8, as rendered by Nan Merrill. O love, my beloved, how powerful is your name in all the earth. You, whose glory is sung in heaven by the angels and saints, who with the innocence and spontaneity of a child, confound those who are mighty and proud. You quiet the unloving and fearful. When I look up at the heavens, at the work of love's creation, at the infinite variety of your plan, what is woman that you rejoice in her, and man that you do delight in him? You have made us in your image. You fill us with your love. You have made us co-creators of the earth, to care for all your creatures, to tend the land, the sea, and the air we breathe. All that you have made, you have placed into our hands. O love, my beloved, how powerful is your name in all the earth. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Crystal. The Holy Gospel according to Mark 10, 13 to 16, People were bringing little children to him, that is Jesus, in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us.
Thanks be to God.
A couple of weeks ago, we were in a chapter prior, Mark 9, and Jesus there talked about welcoming children as a sign of the kingdom. Welcoming children. And we noted the significance of that because children were considered very low on the ladder of social status or social hierarchy in that time. And in fact, children were right at the bottom, considered almost non-entities, nobodies. And it wasn't until you were grown up, at least into the teen years, that you were even considered a legitimate member of the family. We're thinking about doing the opposite. You know, once you're a teenager, why don't you just, you know, go your way for a while. Come back to us once you're done with that phase. But things, as we noted a couple of weeks ago, were not favorable for children in the ancient Mediterranean world. And I remember, you know, reading about that, learning about that, and thinking, well, at least we've come so far. Right? We do a much better job today. But it turns out we ourselves still have work to do. Some recent studies show that still today, children are among the most underserved and neglected members of society. Approximately 1/5 of the nation's young are growing up in poverty. And yet Jesus says that it is welcoming of children, that is the way of the kingdom, and that when we welcome children, we welcome Jesus himself. And this wisdom from Jesus of welcoming the youngest among us is reflected in other traditions and other societies. According to Carlene Old Elk, head of the General Studies Department at Little Bighorn College, all crows, that is members of the crow tribe, are also members of a clan, which is viewed as a large family. And she notes that child rearing becomes a tribal responsibility. She says, children are included in everything from infancy on. They go to all social functions, all political functions. They're a part of the scene. I love that. And yet I cringe at that. As a dad who has growing children who are once very little. And isn't that so different from how we often operate? If we have important meetings, big people events, right? We do everything we can to keep the children out of it, right? Find a sitter, or here's some things to play with and we're gonna do big people stuff. Stay out of the way, you know, don't be seen or heard. That's often how we act in our society and culture. And yet Jesus reminds us that welcoming of children is a critical part of realizing the kingdom of God in our midst. Well, in our text today, Jesus again speaks about children, but in a slightly different way from chapter 9. And notice how the text begins. Verse 13 says, people were bringing little children to him, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. Apparently they weren't listening to Jesus either. Jesus literally just emphasized the importance of welcoming children. And as some folks are bringing some kids his way, the disciples revert to the cultural norm of treating children like dirt. They spoke sternly to them, is how the writer of the Gospel of Mark puts it, but he's probably being kind and keeping the text safe for family reading. Well, Jesus hears this, sees this, and it says, is indignant. And I got to imagine that if Jesus wore a hat, this is where he throws his hat on the ground. Which begs the question, what kind of hat would Jesus wear? I don't know. That's a funny thing to think about. But he's rightly miffed at the disciples. He's rightly miffed at the disciples. Aren't you paying attention? What did I literally just say? And he says in verse 14, "Let the little children come to me, do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs." And last week we talked about the disciples stopping someone from doing good because this person wasn't, quote unquote, part of their team or following them. And so I guess they're just always stopping people from doing things. Jesus is saying, stop stopping people. And you can imagine that as two or three young ones come his way, he gestures and says, it is to such as these that the kingdom of heaven belongs. These little ones are at the heart of the beloved community that I came to create. And then giving his disciples a real stare down, he ups the ante and says, unless you receive the kingdom as a little child, you will never enter it. And he says, and he starts by saying, truly I tell you. Probably not the best translation, but you know when Jesus says, truly I tell you, he means business. And those are serious words, right? Unless you become like a little child, you'll never enter it. And so it's important, I think, for us to explore what that might mean. What is Jesus inviting us to do? How do we become like a child? And that's a hard question because most of us have spent our lives trying to grow up, right? And of course we do grow up, right? That's inevitable, but as we grow, we often lose some things that we had, I think, innately as children. Or we learn at least to sort of tamper them down, put them away, you know, set that aside. But maybe these things are things we need to recapture. And so, the question this morning is, what comes to your mind when we talk about learning from a child? What can we learn from children? Just share a few ideas. Anyone here online?
Being curious.
Being curious. Excellent. You looked at my notes. So that's good.
Spontaneity.
Spontaneity.
I think kids have a sense of openness and vulnerability that we learn to kind of construct walls around with adults.
Absolutely. Openness and vulnerability. Kids are kind of naturally trusting. And as adults, you know, we've been hurt one too many times that we become a little jaded. And sometimes rightly so, trying to protect ourselves, right, from hurt. And that makes sense. And that's appropriate to a degree. But children still have that innate ability to simply trust someone, to see the good in someone. What else?
Unconditional request.
Unconditional
request.
Request. Say more about what you mean by that.
The young child, 2-year-old, it's not conditional. Give me this because I did that. It's because you're the parent.
Yeah.
And the child is the relationship.
Yeah, exactly. It's not always sort of that underlying exchange of whatever. Yeah, good. Anything else?
Honesty.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Spontaneity, says Chris online. Absolutely. Absolutely. We heard someone else mention that. So I have three things that we can learn from children, though there are many more. And number one, we heard right off the bat, be curious. Be curious. Curiosity is a beautiful thing, right? Some of the best teachers know how to nurture curiosity in children. And of course, curiosity in many ways is the engine that drives learning. If you're not interested in something, then, you know, the best teacher in the world is going to have a really hard time getting through to you. You have to have this sort of innate interest in something. And so, you know, kids who are drawn to math see a math problem, they want to figure it out, right? It's like a puzzle. And how does this work? And how do you take this equation and come up with this, you know, figure? And so I think that love of math is can be drawn by, or rooted in curiosity. Others of us are wired to hate math. Also true. But still others are driven by curiosity of the natural world. How do trees grow? What are clouds? How is it that this little wormy type bug can go into a cocoon and then come out with wings that and can fly. And of course, curiosity leads to discovery and learning and so on. But as adults, our sense of curiosity can be dulled. And what do you think the opposite of curiosity might be?
Fear.
Fear, okay. And I don't know if this is a perfect thing, but if you think about it, like certainty could be sort of seen as an opposite of curiosity, right? If you already imagine you know exactly how something is, then you're no longer sort of curious about it. You're no longer curious about it. And certainty leads us to make incorrect assumptions about others. It causes us to believe that our opinions are facts, irrefutable facts. And of course, certainty can lead to trouble, as we all know, in theology and in politics, and how to respond to a global pandemic. And so curiosity might be seen as an antidote to certainty. In Adam Grant's book, Think Again, he explores the idea that the most important cognitive skill is the ability to rethink and unlearn. To rethink and unlearn. Sometimes the thing that gets most in the way of learning is imagining we already know. And so he advocates for seeing disagreements as an opportunity to learn and for opening our minds to hear things that we might disagree with. And he argues that embracing the joy of being wrong can turn us into lifelong learners. The joy of being wrong. I love that, and I wonder if, you know, like, if we sometimes sort of root that out of kids, the joy of being wrong, because I remember as a kid, I would not raise my hand in class unless I felt like 99% sure I had the right answer. Like I did everything possible not to ever be wrong. Like almost had like an unhealthy fear, a phobia of being wrong. Hated to make a mistake. But mistakes are how we learn and how we grow. So I love this idea of joy being wrong. So what can we learn from kids? Number one, be curious. Number two, be creative. Kids, I think, are naturally creative. Naturally creative and often confident in their creativity. There's the story of the little girl in second grade drawing in class. And the teacher comes over and says, "Oh, what are you drawing there?" And the little girl says, "Oh, I'm drawing God." And the teacher says, "Well, nobody knows what God looks like." And this little girl says, "Well, they're about to." So creativity, but also a confidence, right? A confidence in that creativity. And the best teachers know this and know how to nurture creativity in their classes. But historically, a lot of our educational system has been sort of geared toward getting creativity out of the way, right? Because it can complicate the lesson plan or make the classroom disruptive. And so much of our educational system, at least what I experienced, I think good teachers are always finding ways to make it better and are doing better. But a lot of it is geared toward how do you function in the quote-unquote real world? How do you do something productive with your life? You know, how do you find a major that allows you to get a productive job in a field where they're hiring? And it doesn't matter what you're interested in, you know, what can help you pay the bills? And so creativity is often not high on the list. But think back to when you were a kid, right? Did you like to draw? Did you like to paint? Did you like to take Legos and build things without the instructions? And just see what came together? Did you write poems or short stories? And when is the last time you did something like that? Just nurtured and open to your creative side. Well, Christy is away for a few days, so I get to embrace my creative side while she's gone, by which I mean cooking dinner. And so we're trying to expand the menu beyond mac and cheese and cereal. No response. That's it. But if you think about it, right, we're facing some serious issues in our world, and we're going to need creativity to lead us forward. And so we need to learn curiosity from children. And then finally, we learn from kids to be in the moment. To be in the moment, right? Children are in the moment. They see each new day as a fresh start. Each moment is a wonderful chance for fun, for discovery, for play. I love the story that Crystal read earlier when his mom is, you know, running around trying to get ready for the day, right? Trying to do the adult things, right? There's a schedule, there's stuff that has to get done, there's obligations, all the serious business of being an adult. And this kid says, hey, why don't we play a game? We don't have to leave yet. And I love that, right? Just seeing, here's an opportunity to do something fun. Why don't we do that? What is stopping us from doing that? But we're often so wired to, well, fun is this extra that if we work really hard Monday through Friday, we can do a little bit on Saturday. But kids are in the moment, ready to have fun at any time. And of course, we often talk about heavy stuff here, right? About following Jesus. Following Jesus is serious business. Seeking justice and equity in our world is serious business. But sometimes we can let it all get too heavy, maybe too serious. And so Jesus is saying to us grown-ups, us grown-up people, don't take yourself so seriously. Don't be so uptight. Relax. Do something simply because you enjoy it. Smile. Laugh. Play a game. Put your trust in someone. Imagine a better world and laugh some more. Because honestly, what good is a better world that we're working so hard to get to if we're not going to have any fun in it or along the way? And we certainly know kids won't want any part of that world without fun. And according to the prophets of old, it will be children who lead the way. Amen. Maybe so. I want you to stand, if you're able, for our song of response, They'll Know We're God's Children. Opportunity to give of our offerings at this time. If you'd like to make an offering this morning, we have a couple of boxes in the back, and you can also make a contribution online via the Givelify app or our website, hollanducc.org/donate. And as always, we ask that God would use these gifts and us to turn our world upside down with love. And now we have a few moments to share some prayer requests together. Any concerns going on with you or someone close to you, or things happening in our wider world, or anything you would like to celebrate. And if you're tuning in online, feel free to share any requests in the comment section as well. Absolutely. Well, excitement for a new grandchild on the way. Prayers for...
And it's a boy.
Oh, and it's a boy. All right. Someone's excited. Grandma's ready to go.
Boy, mom.
So for the mom and the child, for all to come out healthy and well, we say, oh God, hear our prayers.
And hallelujah.
And hallelujah.
Well, yeah. It's not happened yet. All right. Well, we'll bring the hallelujah next week.
I'm confident it's going to.
So. Yes. We're entrusting it to be one.
Yes.
Sometimes it's like right in the middle. Yeah.
Colleen and my sister-in-law, Joy Mahone, passed away very unexpectedly yesterday morning. Don't really know why. She'd been hospitalized for a few days. Wasn't COVID, I just really don't know. So,
is this a younger, older?
Just a little bit older than Colleen.
Yeah.
Colleen's brother's wife. So,
I see her brother's wife.
Yeah, her brother's wife. So, prayers for her husband David and their son Dave at this time.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. So sorry to hear that, Doug, and thinking of Colleen and you, and obviously the family, as mentioned, in this time of loss. So we'll ask that God would give this family comfort and peace in this time of grieving. We say, oh God, hear our prayers.
No, I have a friend, Joe. He was at Cleveland Clinic. He had a double lung transplant about 3 weeks ago. He's doing really well.
Okay. Is this who David has mentioned as well?
Joe.
David Roman?
Joe Brown.
Could be.
Oh, could be. We weren't here last
year. Yeah. Okay. David Roman has mentioned a Joe getting a lung transplant.
Yeah, exactly.
So anyway, well, if it's the same or different Joe, we'll pray for both.
How many Joes are given on?
And how's it, and what's the latest again?
He's doing really well.
Doing well.
Yeah.
Okay. Awesome. Well, we'll give thanks for that, for this really serious procedure for friend Joe with this double lung transplant. And we'll give praise and say thanks be to God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Yeah.
I'd like to ask for continued prayers for my brother, Fred, in the Philippines, who remains very ill in the hospital.
Okay, so sorry to hear that, Joan. We'll continue to pray for your brother, Fred, for strength and healing. So for Fred, we say, oh God, hear our prayers. The joy of hearing kids having fun, learning, I love that. It's a good thing. And the sound in this room is kind of nice. Like, I love being up on the roof, but there's always that road noise. You know, here we can hear each other, which I don't mind.
I am super grateful for safe travels for Scott and I, but one thing we noticed in North Dakota is it is dry. They need rain. It's terribly bad there. As where I'm standing watching the rain this morning, I'm thinking, oh, I wish I could send this to North Dakota. I mean, to the point where they were telling us in national parks, no smoking outside. You had to smoke in your car.
Also not recommended, by the way.
It's terribly dry. They need rain.
Yeah, okay. Well, we are so glad you guys are back. We missed you and loved following along a little bit with the photos online. Looked like a wonderful journey. So for a terrific trip, a chance to explore God's creation, and a safe return, we say thanks be to God. Hallelujah. And for the folks in North Dakota and elsewhere that are in need of rain, we lift that up to God. Say, oh God, hear our prayers.
One of my closest friends, his wife passed away really unexpectedly, and he has two children that are like 2 and 5.
Oh man.
So he's trying to figure that out right now.
Yeah. What's his first name?
Ken.
Ken. Okay. Wow. So sorry, Steve, to hear that. And we'll certainly hold Ken and that young family in our prayers in this time of unexpected and unbelievable loss. So for this young family, we say, oh God,
hear our prayers.
Christy is out on a little hiking trip with Amy Alkema for a few days. They're exploring Vermont, so prayers for safe travel for them are certainly welcome and appreciated. Anyone else have anything online? Krista says, celebrating the excellent showing yesterday at the Women's March and gratitude to Jill and Jen who helped organize and the powerful speakers. Absolutely. I was sorry I couldn't join given other responsibilities, but from the photos, just looked like a fantastic turnout, great energy and powerful speakers on behalf of women and women's rights. So for those organizing and speaking up in our community, we say thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Jean asks for prayers for the 700,000 families who have lost a loved one to COVID and prayers for medical staff who are getting burned out. Absolutely, Jean. We continue to hold in our prayers those who are grieving loss of a loved one, those who are currently ill with the virus, and of course our healthcare workers working so hard. So we lift that up to God and say, oh God, hear our prayers. And Andrew from over in Scotland says, I've been looking for a new job for a few months now, so prayers for the right one to come along would be great. So Andrew, glad to have you with us from across the pond, and certainly we'll hold you in our prayers as you seek a job that works and fits and utilizes your gifts and creativity. So for Andrew in this search, we say, oh God,
hear our prayers.
Well, we know there's so much more happening in our world than what we've given voice to at this time. So if there's anything else you're holding on to, I invite you to lift that up to God in the silence. Stand if you're able and join us for our closing doxology, which we will sing as usual a cappella.
Come thou from whom all blessings flow, wake us to see more than we know. Help us claim all our gifts and power. Fill us with grace that for this.
few announcements before we part ways here this morning. This Tuesday, Justice Action Team has its monthly planning meeting. That's 7 o'clock via Zoom. Love to have you join us for that. The link is in the weekly email that goes out on Fridays. You can subscribe on our website if you're not getting that. Wednesday, Pub Theology, 6 o'clock, again at Greg and Jude's on Church Street in Holland. Thursday, contemplative practice session. Laura, there was a climate thing happening that I forgot to add in. Can you tell us what that is?
Thursday evening at the Outdoor Discovery Center, we're going to have the Citizens Climate Lobby. It's going to have a panel discussion on local climate action. Four candidates for city council were invited, and Ken Freestone and Belinda Coronado, who I think is running in this Ward 3 district, have accepted to come. So there is on the bar back there, I laid a flyer down if you're interested. It's Thursday night at 6:30 at the ODC, the Outdoor Discovery.
Great, thank you so much. Chance to hear a couple of candidates for Holland City Council on important climate and creation issues. Great. Next Sunday, our youth group will kick off. So middle schoolers, high schoolers, love to have you join us. We're going to meet, weather permitting, over at Collin Park for some food, some games, some fun, and sort of look ahead at future gatherings. And a reminder, last Sunday of the month, both in October and November, we're going to do a sleep-in Sunday. It's going to be all online. Give a little break to our volunteers. Give us a chance to reconnect via Zoom Sunday coffee on those Sundays. So we look forward to that happening October 31. There are signups if you'd like to serve on the back counter. And so if you'd like to help in any of the ways listed below, we'd love to have you sign up there. And you can always go online to hollanduccc.org or follow us on social media for the latest. And now, friends, as you go, may you become a little more like a child, with a ready smile, an open heart, and a big imagination. And may you dream of a world more beautiful than anything we have seen yet. Amen.